Francis Scott Key. Francis Scott Key, August 1, 1779 January 11, 1843, was an American lawyer, author, and amateur poet from Frederick, Maryland, who was best known for writing a poem which later became the lyrics for the United States national anthem, the Star-Spangled Banner. During the War of 1812, Key observed the British bombardment of Fort McHenry in Maryland in 1814. Key was inspired upon viewing the American flag still flying over the fort at dawn, and wrote the poem Defense of Fort McHenry, which was published a week later. The poem was adapted to the tune of the popular song To Anacreon in Heaven. The song with Key's lyrics became known as the Star-Spangled Banner, and slowly gained in popularity as an unofficial anthem over the years, finally achieving official status a century later under President Woodrow Wilson as the United States national anthem. Key was a lawyer in Maryland and Washington, D.C. for four decades, and worked on important cases like the Burr conspiracy trial, and argued numerous times before the U.S. Supreme Court. Nominated for U.S. Attorney by President Andrew Jackson, he served from 1833 to 1841. Key owned slaves from 1800, during which time abolitionists ridiculed his words, that America was more like the land of the free and home of the oppressed. He freed his slaves in the 1830s, paying one ex-slave as his farm foreman. Key publicly criticized slavery and gave free legal representation to some slaves seeking freedom, but also represented owners of runaway slaves as well. Representing both slaves and slave owners is emblematic of his complex relationship with slavery. As district attorney, Key suppressed abolitionists and didn't support an immediate end to slavery. Referring to blacks as a distinct and inferior race of people, he was a leader of the American Colonization Society, which sent freed slaves back to Africa. Key was a devout Episcopalian. He was also an author of poetry, and often wrote on religious themes. It has been speculated that the U.S. motto "In God We Trust" was adapted from a line in the fourth stanza of the Star-Spangled Banner. Francis Scott Key's father, John Ross Key, was a lawyer, a commissioned officer in the Continental Army, and a judge. John was born in Frederick, Colony of Maryland, on September 19, 1754, the son of Francis Key and Anne Arnold Ross. Francis Key's father was English settler Philip Key, Scott Key's great-grandfather, who resided near Leonardtown around 1726. He married Susanna Gardner and had seven children. Scott Key's mother, Anne Phoebe Dagworthy Charlton, was born February 6, 1756, to Arthur Charlton, a tavern keeper, and his wife, Eleanor Harrison of Frederick, Colony of Maryland. Her ancestry can be traced back to a Henry Charlton who arrived as a young man aboard the George in 1623, settling in Virginia. However, very little of this ancestor is known. Francis Scott Key was born to Anne Phoebe Penn Dagworthy Charlton and Captain John Ross Key at the family plantation Terra Rubra in what was then part of Frederick County, now Carroll County, Maryland. Key graduated from St. John's College, Annapolis, Maryland, in 1796, and read the law under an uncle, Philip Barton Key, who was, along with his wife, loyal to the British Crown during the War of Independence. He married Mary Taylor Lloyd on January 1, 1802. During the War of 1812, Key, accompanied by the British prisoner exchange agent Colonel John Stuart Skinner, dined aboard the British ship HMS Tunnant as the guests of three British officers, Vice Admiral Alexander Cochrane, Rear Admiral George Coburn, and Major General Robert Ross. Skinner and Key were there to negotiate the release of prisoners, one of whom was Dr. William Beans, a resident of Upper Marlborough, Maryland, who had been arrested after jailing marauding British troops who were looting local farms. Skinner, Key, and Beans were not allowed to return to their own sloop because they had become familiar with the strength and position of the British units and with the British intent to attack Baltimore. Thus, Key was unable to do anything but watch the bombarding of the American forces at Fort McHenry during the Battle of Baltimore on the night of September 13, 14, 1814. At dawn, Key was able to see an American flag still waving. Back in Baltimore and inspired, Key wrote a poem about his experience, Defense of Fort McHenry, which was soon published in William Petchin's American and Commercial Daily Advertiser on September 21, 1814. He took it to Thomas Carr, a music publisher, who adapted it to the rhythms of composer John Stafford Smith's To Anacreon in Heaven, a popular tune Key had already used as a setting for his 1805 song When the Warrior Returns, celebrating U.S. heroes of the First Barbary War. Key used the star-spangled flag imagery in the earlier song. It has become better known as the Star-Spangled Banner. Though somewhat difficult to sing, It became increasingly popular, competing with Hail, Columbia, 1796, as the de facto national anthem by the time of the Mexican-American War and American Civil War. More than a century after its first publication, the song was adopted as the American national anthem, first by an executive order from President Woodrow Wilson in 1916, which had little effect beyond requiring military bands to play what became known as the service version, and then by a congressional resolution in 1931, signed by President Herbert Hoover. He was a leading attorney in Frederick, Maryland, and Washington, D.C., for many years, with an extensive real estate as well as trial practice. He and his family settled in Georgetown in 1805 or 1806, near the new national capital. There the young Key assisted his uncle, the prominent lawyer Philip Barton Key, such as in the sensational conspiracy trial of Aaron Burr and the expulsion of Senator John Smith of Ohio. He made the first of his many arguments before the United States Supreme Court in 1807. In 1808 he assisted President Thomas Jefferson's Attorney General in United States. Peters. In 1829, Key, a supporter of Andrew Jackson, assisted in the prosecution of Tobias Watkins, former U.S. Treasury auditor under former President John Quincy Adams for misappropriating public monies. He also handled the petticoat affair concerning Secretary of War John Eaton, who had married a widowed saloonkeeper. In 1832, he served as the attorney for Sam Houston, then a former U.S. representative and governor of Tennessee, during his trial for assaulting Representative William Stanbury of Ohio. President Jackson nominated Key for United States Attorney for the District of Columbia in 1833. After the U.S. Senate approved the nomination, he served from 1833 to 1841, while also handling his own private legal cases. In 1835, in his most famous case, he prosecuted Richard Lawrence for his unsuccessful attempt to assassinate President Andrew Jackson at the entrance doors and top steps of the Capitol, the first attempt to kill an American chief executive. Key purchased his first slave in 1800 or 1801 and owned six slaves in 1820. Mostly in the 1830s, Key manumitted, set free, seven slaves, one of whom, Clem Johnson, continued to work for him for wages as his farm's foreman, supervising several slaves. Throughout his career, Key also represented several slaves seeking their freedom in court, for free, as well as several masters seeking return of their runaway slaves. Key, Judge William Lee of Halifax, and Bishop William Meade were administrators of the will of their friend John Randolph of Roanoke, who died without children and left a will directing his executors to free his more than 400 slaves. Over the next decade, beginning in 1833, the administrators fought to enforce the will and provide the freed slaves land to support themselves. Key publicly criticized slavery's cruelties, so much that after his death a newspaper editorial stated so actively hostile was he to the peculiar institution that was called the nigger lawyer, because he often volunteered to defend the downtrodden sons and daughters of Africa. Mr. Key convinced me that slavery was wrong, radically wrong. In June 1842, Key attended the funeral of William Coaston, a free, mixed-race resident who had challenged Washington's surety bond laws. Key was a founding member and active leader of the American Colonization Society and its predecessor, the influential Maryland branch, the primary goal of which was to send free African Americans back to Africa. However, he was removed from the board in 1833 as its policies shifted toward abolitionism. Key used his position as U.S. attorney to suppress abolitionists. In 1833, he secured a grand jury indictment against Benjamin Lundy, editor of the anti-slavery publication, The Genius of Universal Emancipation, and his printer, William Greer, for libel after Lundy published an article that declared, "There is neither mercy nor justice for colored people in this District of Columbia." Lundy's article, Key said in the indictment, was intended to injure, oppress, aggrieve, and vilify the good name, fame, credit and reputation of the magistrates and constables of Washington. Lundy left town rather than face trial. Greer was acquitted. In August 1836, Key agreed to prosecute botanist and Dr. Reuben Crandall, brother of controversial Connecticut school teacher Prudence Crandall, who had recently moved to the national capital. Key secured an indictment for seditious libel after two marshals, who operated as slave catchers in their off hours, found Crandall had a trunk full of anti-slavery publications in his Georgetown residence, 5 days after the Snow Riot, caused by rumors that a mentally ill slave had attempted to kill an elderly white woman. In an April 1837 trial that attracted nationwide attention, Key charged that Crandall's actions instigated slaves to rebel. Crandall's attorneys acknowledged he opposed slavery, but denied any intent or actions to encourage rebellion. He, in his final address to the jury, said, "The jury acquitted Crandall." This defeat, as well as family tragedies in 1835, diminished Key's political ambition. He resigned as district attorney in 1840. He remained a staunch proponent of African colonization and a strong critic of the anti-slavery movement until his death. Key was a devout and prominent Episcopalian. In his youth, he almost became an Episcopal priest rather than a lawyer. Throughout his life, he sprinkled biblical references in his correspondence. He was active in All Saints Parish in Frederick, Maryland, near his family's home. He also helped found or financially support several parishes in the new national capital, including St. John's Church in Georgetown and Christ Church in Alexandria. From 1818 until his death in 1843, Key was associated with the American Bible Society. He successfully opposed an abolitionist resolution presented to that group around 1838. Key also helped found two Episcopal seminaries, one in Baltimore and the other across the Potomac River in Alexandria, Virginia, the Virginia Theological Seminary. Key also published a prose work called The Power of Literature, and its connection with religion in 1834. The U.S. national motto "In God We Trust" was adapted from a phrase in Key's Star-Spangled Banner, the fourth stanza of which includes the phrase, "And this be our motto, in God is our trust," leading some to speculate that the phrase was derived from the song. On January 11, 1843, Key died at the home of his daughter Elizabeth Howard in Baltimore from pleurisy at age 63. He was initially interred in Old St. Paul's Cemetery in the vault of John Eager Howard, but in 1866, his body was moved to his family plot in Frederick at Mount Olivet Cemetery. The Key Monument Association erected a memorial in 1898, and the remains of both Francis Scott Key and his wife, Mary Taylor Lloyd, were placed in a crypt in the base of the monument. Despite several efforts to preserve it, the Francis Scott Key residence was ultimately dismantled in 1947. The residence had been located at 351618 Adams Street in Georgetown. Though Key had written poetry from time to time, often with heavily religious themes, these works were not collected and published until 14 years after his death. Two of his religious poems used as Christian hymns include "Before the Lord We Bow" and "Lord, with glowing heart I praise Thee." In 1806, Key's sister, Anne Phoebe Charlton Key, married Roger B. Taney, who would later become Chief Justice of the United States. In 1846, one daughter, Alice, married U.S. Senator George H. Pendleton, and another, Ellen Lloyd, married Simon F. Blunt. In 1859, Key's son Philip Barton Key II was shot and killed by Daniel Sicklace, a U.S. representative from New York who would serve as a general in the American Civil War, after he discovered that Philip Barton Key was having an affair with his wife. Sickles was acquitted in the first use of the temporary insanity defense. In 1861, Key's grandson Francis Key Howard was imprisoned in Fort McHenry with the mayor of Baltimore George William Brown and other locals deemed pro-South. Key was a distant cousin and the namesake of F. Scott Fitzgerald, whose full name was Francis Scott Key Fitzgerald. His direct descendants include geneticist Thomas Hunt Morgan, guitarist Dana Key, and American fashion designer and socialite Pauline de Rothschild. Thanks for watching. Don't forget like the video and don't forget to subscribe.